So the most common posture we'd probably see is something like upper and lower cross syndrome. In this posture, you're going to see an increase in anterior pelvic tilt and the shoulders round forward. The reason for this is because these structures are trying to make it so that you have an even center of gravity going down the midline of your body. If your spinal curves increase down below, they're either going to have to increase up top, or you're going to have a lot of tightness and compression of the muscles on the backside of the ribcage in order for you to essentially not excessively fall forward because your pelvis is so forward. So we can visualize this now by looking at the influence of this forward pelvic orientation right here on the rib cage, specifically in the thoracic vertebrae. Obviously, if this pelvic tilt is increased, then you're gonna see a compression of the muscles on the low back. But what's often underappreciated is how this medial inner edge of the scapula is going to end up becoming compressed against the posterior rib cage. And then that's going to lead to an inability of the structure of the scapula to glide smoothly and freely on the rib cage. This scapula has to have a nice paired motion with the rest of the rib cage. The scapula is actually a rounded structure which needs to glide smoothly. It's actually kind of a concave structure which needs to sit on a rib cage that pushes out a little bit and has a little bit of flexion and rounding. We can visualize this by looking at what happens as this arm comes overhead. You can see the further I get this arm overhead, the more progressive upward rotation of the scapula needs to begin to happen in order to accommodate that. The scapula is actually a concave structure sitting on a convex ribcage. You can imagine that by cupping your hands together like this and imagining the glide happening. But if we had an influence from the pelvis down here, where this is being pushed forward and then this back arches even more, then you're going to see a compression of the inner edge of the scapula against the posterior rib cage. And then this upward rotation is going to be blocked because this is already compressed against the rib cage down here. So you can imagine that as if you took this and flattened it out, and now the scapula has nowhere to go. If you want to imagine this on yourself, you can just stand up and you can arch your back. And then what you want to do is keep your elbow perfectly forward, keep your shoulder out of your ear as you go up, and you're going to get blocked right around here. But if you were to tuck your hips and do a posterior rotation, all of a sudden that feels much more free because you haven't pinned this scapula against the rib cage. The body loves to compensate to find what it doesn't have. A very common thing you'll see when the body's trying to find range of motion or balance through the midline of the body, if the lumbar curve is too strong and too large, or if we have a flat back posture where you see this rounded inwards and a posterior pelvic orientation that could be excessive, what you could see is these shoulders cave in and come forward in an attempt to either find the missing range of motion or balance out a pelvis that's coming too far back. So what we would want to do is depress our chest so that we can come forward so we don't feel like we're falling too far back. Now in this instance, what you're going to see is the shoulders round forward like so, and that pulls the scapula further away from the spine. But in essence, what you're probably going to end up doing is internally rotating the scapula too much. When the scapula internally rotates, it rotates inwards away from the spine like this. Now that brings our humerus right here into a degree of internal rotation like so. When that happens, as this guy stares you down right here, you're probably going to be limited in your ability to actually get your arm overhead in the first place, because for a very similar reason, you're blocking the motions that need to occur. And you can visualize this on yourself right now. If you push your shoulders forward and try to get your arm overhead, it's gonna be really hard unless you deviate that arm outwards. But what you're actually doing when you deviate your arm outwards is you're actually going into more internal rotation because you can't find external rotation. In order to visualize that, you can just think about it like this. This humerus bone needs to actually, as you get beyond about 90 degrees, it needs to externally rotate and turn out like this. So if you felt the need to deviate your elbow outwards as you went overhead, which is very common by the way, what you're probably going to see is because this humerus needs to turn out as it comes up further beyond about 120-ish degrees, what you're going to see is the scapula be unable to upwardly rotate or move. So the humerus is going to internally rotate and turn outwards like that as you go overhead. And now I'm blocked on the skeleton model. This won't even let me go any higher because I'm essentially stuck right here. And the only way I can go higher is if I turn out like so, and that would be the humerus right here rotating inwards because it can't rotate into external rotation. Now let's get a little bit more complicated. If we have a pelvis that is oriented in one direction or the other, so let's say it's forward on one side and rotated back on the other. So you're probably going to see a higher hip on this side right here. You can see what happens to my skeleton model when I do that. He's going to turn right in this instance because the left hip is forward. So when this happens, in order to even ourselves out, in order to manage gravity the best, so we don't walk in a circle to the right, we're probably going to need to rotate our trunk in the other direction. We're probably going to need to do this right here. So what you're probably going to see in this instance is the shoulder drop on the right and raise on the left as the spine rotates to the opposite direction like so. This brings this shoulder into more internal rotation, and this brings this shoulder into more external rotation as you see that uneven shoulder start to develop. If you paid close attention, when this shoulder drops and this chest wall rotates back to the left, you can see how that would cause a compression or depression of the ribs on this side as they come down and become compressed, and this chest wall opens up. This is going to be more inflated, whereas this chest wall is going to be more deflated. So we can think about the position of the bones, and we can think of the muscles that get tight as a result, and that's what we feel ultimately, but it's actually a rib cage and pelvis issue. If we were able to inflate this chest wall, we would bring this back, and if we were able to bring our left hip back, then we wouldn't need to actually be rotated towards the right. We would be able to even ourselves out a little bit more. So we can think of all the muscles that are affected as a result of these orientations, but the important thing to consider is that it's a lot about the rib cage and it's a lot about the pelvis. Addressing the proximal, bigger structures first is ultimately going to give us more bang for our buck because we're not just worrying about muscles, because muscular orientation is secondary to the position of the skeleton. If I have a depressed chest wall right here, then the muscles that are going to pull this shoulder forward are probably going to be in a tighter, more concentric state. So if we were able to actually inflate this chest wall, then we would probably be able to bring that rib cage back into a better position, and the shoulder and scapula will follow. Same thing with down here. If I have a forward pelvis on the left and my trunk is rotating right, but it wants to kind of rotate back to the left, what we would probably want to do is address this underlying pelvic orientation via bringing the left hip back and evening ourselves out a little bit more. I have a full-length video on what shoulder limitations could be happening as a result of specific assessment results that you could easily do on yourself, and then specific exercises you can do to restore the function of the scapula, restore the function of the pelvis. But ultimately, this video is just here to demonstrate the fact that this lower body and pelvis is driving so much of what's happening at top.